I'm pleased to welcome you here at the group exhibit Hydrogen Fuel Cells and Battery in the Technical Forum. Please come in, have a seat, have a drink on the house, and enjoy with me our next presentation dealing with the topic, the Flex Fuel Reformer, a new concept for decentralized hydrogen infrastructure. And the presentator is von der Technischen Universität Graz, dem Institut für Chemische Verfahrenstechnik und Umwelttechnik, Professor Dr. Viktor Hacker. Give him a big hand, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you. Thank you very much for the kind introduction. My name is Viktor Hacker, and I want to take the chance today to introduce you to our concept of a decentralized hydrogen production, which is the so-called Flex Fuel Reformer. I belong to the Chemical Engineering Institute of Graz University of Technology. We do for quite a while component development in the field of hydrogen production, and this is the first time for us at least that we realize a complete system, and this is based on our own development, a complete system in form of a prototype, which will be ready this year. We have here a booth and you can see the concept there, but the system will be produced this year at our institute, and then the final or an important evaluation of the complete system will take place. What is the goal? The goal is a decentralized small scale production. Why? Because we think that on the big scale there is enough available. There's commercial technology available, and so we don't see the market in this area. Graz University of Technology, in the southern part of Austria, maybe, I just, yeah. Here is the engineering campus on the left downside. Left up is the old building of the university, more than 200 years. On the right side, some sightseeing places of Graz. I want to give you an overview today of what we think is the difference to the conventional hydrogen production, the concept of the reformer steam iron process, then the flex fuel reformer system, and some highlights. Conventional hydrogen production, like it is today, you are very much aware of it, 90% of the worldwide hydrogen production is based on fossil fuels. The hydrogen storage and transportation are still challenging, and the decentralized hydrogen production would be a solution to the transportation problem, and also that the decentralized hydrogen production makes it possible to use biogas, use renewable hydrocarbons. This is anyway a goal, so we go to the small units to use the decentralized available renewable hydrocarbons. One more. Already today, hydrogen is available on a big scale to a reasonable price, like you can see on the left side, but it is not available on a reasonable price on the decentralized location like you need it. And that's why we also believe that it is our goal to decentralize the hydrogen production. Like some published prices are here, and you can see 1 euro per kilogram on the centralized station, up to 9 euro per kilogram on the after transportation and storage, which could be solved by decentralized efficient production. What is available on the small scale? On the small scale available are technologies like partial oxidation with following steps of cleaning the hydrogen. But first of all, you have a number of steps which might make the process inefficient. And second of all, you produce a hydrogen gas which is still diluted by CO2, nitrogen, or maybe also impurities, which should not be. This we have solved. The membrane-based steam reforming would be a solution to it, but it's still not it's still not economically available. So a membrane-based system would produce pure hydrogen on a small scale, but as far as we know, it is still too expensive and has still some technical issues. Small-scale electrolysis is of course an option, but it's a different option. It's based on electricity, not on hydrocarbons, so we work on hydrocarbons, and the biological hydrogen production is anyway a primary energy carrier, and it is an option, and you also need usually a hydrogen purification, so it might be also an option for us. Let's come to the reformer steam iron process. Hydrogen was discovered by the reaction of water with red hot iron, and so this is already the concept of the steam iron process, and the patents on this process, they go back to the 19th and 20th century. So the basic concept is known very long. The hydrogen for the Zeppelins were made by a steam iron process, but it changed then after that, and it became the reforming of natural gas. Natural gas reforming is the centralized production unit, produces very cheap fossil-based hydrogen, and makes this very hydrogen inexpensive, available for refining industry. But this is definitely not our goal. It's centralized and it's based on fossil. We go decentralized and it should be based on renewable. Of course, we can also do it with fossils and it might be necessary, but it would be better to do it with a renewable energy carrier like biogas. And that's why flex fuel, so that you really use different kinds of hydrocarbons. How does it work? It is a two-step process, so discontinuous two steps, but if you use several reactors parallel, it's a continuous process. Of course, we make it to a continuous process. So at the end, the water gas shift reaction is part of it, but we reduce iron oxide. In this case, it is magnetite with a synthesis gas. So a fuel gas, which includes different fuel components, reduce the iron oxide-based contact mass, produce iron, and produce an exhaust gas, which is mainly consisting of steam and CO2. And in the second step, we have the oxidation. We simply add water or steam to the iron, and we produce pure hydrogen. So two steps, discontinuous, has one main advantage. You separate the fuel stream from the product gas stream. The product gas stream has not the same impurities or no impurities, hopefully. So that means the product gas stream is hydrogen and steam. Steam is there because you don't react completely. And the fuel gas stream is here. So you do not contact each other. You have two different streams. What might be a problem, I also have to tell, carbon deposition. Carbon deposition is a matter of temperature and a matter of CO2 content, but you can avoid it. So when you compare it to a conventional decentralized reformer unit like it is here, you have, like it is available, a steam reformer, high temperature shift, a low temperature shift, then you're in a range with 100 ppm, I would say, CO, and then usually you have to add another fine purification step, and all after these three purification steps, you have still CO2 quite a lot in your gas stream. This is avoided here. Here we have, we need a rough reformer at the beginning, and then we need a two-step, discontinuous two-step process, and the advantage is that in the second step, we produce hydrogen, which is only diluted by steam. Only steam is there, no CO2, no CO, and other impurities. Basically, it also can be used as hydrogen storage. This is definitely not the goal of this project, but iron as hydrogen storage was always an issue in some applications, but on the short term, it's also used here. You reduce your iron oxide, you have iron, and you can produce hydrogen out of it at any rate you want. It's a very fast process. You have no dynamic limitations in the second step. You could also do it on the long term, and it's often, and it was at least in the past, discussed, the storage density is 4.8 weight percent, so it's better than many hydrogen storages used nowadays, but it's not good enough at the end for a mobile application. 4.8% would be possible if you really put pure iron in your tank and oxidize it with water, which is not included here, and then you get 4.8% mass percent hydrogen. The advantage is it's not dangerous or not very dangerous. You can store it over a long time. You can store it quite efficient. But the disadvantage is, of course, that you store it on ambient temperature, and then for the reduction, for the oxidation, you need some 100 degrees. So we don't go into detail of this hydrogen storage, but we can do it on the short term. That means minutes and hours, which you reduce, and then it's hot there, and you can then oxidize it whenever you want it. Okay, we come to the highlights. What is being done now is written here. That means based on the component development, which was done in the last years, and we also papers were published in this field, we are now in a project which is called Research Studio. We realize a complete system in the range of 1 kilowatt hydrogen equivalent power, so 1 kilowatt hydrogen flow. This will happen this year, the system, and will be evaluated. And then we hope to find some partners to go on in the field of commercialization. The advantage is PEM-grade hydrogen, so very pure hydrogen, no inert gases. Pressurized hydrogen is also a step that we now do it under 11 bar, but we hope that we can do it considerably higher pressure, up to, let's say, 50 to 100 bar. And there are no expensive materials included in this process, so it's basically inexpensive and safe materials are used. The contact mass is being developed. I mean, this is, of course, the main difference to the old process. The old process was a one-step process where you use iron to produce hydrogen once. Now you have a cyclic process. And the cyclic process is, of course, the challenge, because iron is a very cheap material. Iron is a very cheap material. So we could change it very often, but it's a logistic problem to change it all the time. So we have to have a material, we call it contact mass. The contact mass should be over thousands of cycles stable. I mean, we are now up to now hundreds of cycles stable, but the goal is, of course, thousands of cycles that you exchange it every few years. That's going on. So the contact mass is being developed. It's based on hematite, on iron oxide, but you need to add a number of metal oxides and other materials to make it stable and keep the reactivity high. It is then dried, fractionating, and pretreatment. These are the steps which are used. And then, of course, several methods of investigation of reactivity and stability of the contact masses are applied. Now, only very roughly, I mean, a few results. I mean, if you start here to investigate the hydrogen conversion over the time, if you put hematite into your reactor, you have 100% conversion. Then the hematite is reduced to magnetite and wüstite, and the conversion changes inside the reactor. But you are always very close to the thermodynamic equilibrium. High temperature, I mean, basically, you are very close to the mathematical thermodynamic calculations. And this is now the other step, the oxidation step. That means you have iron in your reactor and put steam over it, and then you see how the complete reactor mass is slowly converted into magnetite in this case. Okay. A challenge is, of course, the degradation, and this is shown here, the degradation. That means you have the complete conversion, the maximum hydrogen conversion, but in this contact mass shows a degradation already, that the maximum conversion changes earlier from every cycle. So the reactivity of the contact mass is reduced, and you don't have the high reaction kinetics like you have in the beginning of the process. This is only one test equipment like used. I mean, we use the thermobalance for very small milligrams. We use this for bigger samples like grams of masses, and then we go up to a bigger reformer where we use kilograms of contact masses to make the investigations. I mean, it's full automatic controlled. You can make long time testing, and you can mix the gases in front automatically, and after the test equipment there is a gas analysis, and you get the results of the oxidation and the reduction process. This is now the bigger kind where the reactor in the kilogram scale could be tested. We tested also here with methane, also methane flow, methane CO2 mixtures, and the steam to carbon ratio is given here 1 to 1.5. And the reduction oxidation temperature is also a matter of optimization, but is chosen here between 600 and 800 degrees. Nitrogen flow is not necessary, but was applied here with 100 milliliter per minute. And what I want to show you here is going into the contact mass with a synthesis gas produced out of methane means methane over the contact mass and the time it is shown that you go slowly, that in the beginning you have a very low hydrogen content, and then it reaches up to the thermodynamical equilibrium, and the CO content as well, and the CO2 content goes down. What you see on the right side is that the simulation and the experiments are very close, and this is maybe really an advantage of this high temperature process, that you very fast reach the thermodynamic equilibria for all the processes. And so I think the system efficiency is very reliable. This is now the other way around, that we make the oxidation and the hydrogen production in the same contact mass. That means the CO2 was still measured here with 0.3%. The CO was not quantified, but you have to optimize the operation in the big scale, because usually you cannot completely avoid carbon deposition in the whole reactor, and then you might find some CO in your oxidation process. And the dry gas composition is on the right side, again, compared between the simulation and the experiment, and usually you are quite close to it. So you can also here depend on the simulation of the whole process quite well. So then we come slowly. Why do we think that, where are the advantage of this reformer steam iron process? We will be capable to produce high pressure hydrogen. High pressure hydrogen is a very important thing, especially on decentralized units, because you have to store it. Ambient pressure hydrogen production on decentralized unit will need a compressor which needs electricity. So high pressure hydrogen is a main challenge, I would say, for decentralized hydrogen production. No moving parts, cheap and safe materials. You could produce a pure CO2 stream for CCS application, that means carbon capture and storage, whoever is interested in it. And it's a simple and a compact design, because you don't have a lot of units, you don't have a lot of steps to purify the hydrogen. This is, I think, also the main advantages are shown here compared to conventional, already available processes. What we are now realizing, 200 watt pure hydrogen from methane, PEM grade hydrogen from synthesis gas based on biogas or based on natural gas. The hydrogen pressure at the moment is 11 bar, but we will go up to 50 bar. And at the end, it will be, in this year, the goal will be 1 kilowatt, a 1 kilowatt unit based on methane and biogas, which is in the end a mixture of methane and CO2 mainly. where we are here, we are very close here, B66, booth number E67. So please feel free to pass by and ask questions. We are very interested in cooperating. It's a development basically made at university, basically made on basic research. And this time we take the steps to the prototype quite close to the market for university, I would say, but we will not go the whole way. So thank you very much for your attention.
So it's now time on me to thank you, Professor Acker, for this very interesting presentation. Yeah, and now the turn is on you. Are here any questions in the audience right now?
Thank you for your presentation. Would you tell me the efficiency and the lifetime and the target price of your reformer?
Okay, the target price is a difficult question. We are not so far. We are now in the range of hundreds of cycles. As I told you, the contact mass is very inexpensive, but the exchange of contact masses may be expensive. So we try to go up to a few thousands of cycles. A few thousands of cycles means if you, how many cycles a day? One cycle a day, maybe. It depends how you use it then. Your reformer. If you use it daily or weekly, it should be up to 5 years, I would say, but depends on the usage. The efficiency depends on the quality of your gas. The efficiency depends on the quality of your gas because you reach the thermodynamic equilibrium. If you have a very low value gas, then your efficiency will go down to, I would say, from the fuel heating value to the hydrogen heating value, you will be in the range of, 50 to 70%. It depends on the quality of the gas you introduce. If you have a high value gas, if you go to with pure methane or ethanol or some other hydrocarbon, you reach considerably higher. I would say 80 to 90% are possible, but this depends on the hydrocarbon you use.
Do you use a desulfurizer also? Desulfurizer?
We have to use at the moment, yes. But this also is for the future, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Are here any other questions right now? Okay. No.
Okay.
You just. Okay, so thank you very much again. And if there are coming any questions later on your mind or you want to discuss directly with Professor Hacker, just please do not hesitate and visit him and his colleagues at the booth, like mentioned, E67/2. Thank you very much. We have now a short break and continue our program with the next topic, power to gas under safety aspects. Thank you very much.